Welcome to the University of Michigan Dentistry Podcast Series, promoting oral health care worldwide.
This is a case where we have space just in the midline between the two maxillary incisors. It's probably due to a discrepancy between the arch length and the size of the teeth. Oftentimes, people think the etiologic cause of such a midline diastema is the frenulum. As you can see, the frenulum in this case does not blanch the tissue between the incisors when we raise the upper lip. Most of the evidence supports the fact that the frenulum is not related to the cause, in that if we close the space and remove the frenulum, it seems to open the same amount as if we hadn't removed the frenulum. The treatment procedures that can be used in such a case would be to put orthodontic bands on the first molar teeth and bands on the four incisor teeth. These could be done either with conventional bands or the new direct bonded acrylic brackets. This might be recommended if we wanted to move teeth sideways along an arch wire, or if we felt that we needed control over the root apices. However, in this case, we feel that there is sufficient room to merely tip the teeth posteriorly and close the space in this manner, in which case a Hawley appliance that we will show you after going off camera for a while is the appliance of choice, in that we also run into a retention problem with any midline closure. And our choices of retention after closing the space would be either pin ledge inlays on the lingual surface of the maxillary incisor teeth, which would hold the teeth together once the space has been closed, or periodic wearing of a retainer, a removable, like a Hawley, perhaps once a week for the duration of the time that the teeth tend to move apart, which may be actually a lifetime permanent retention. Because we have room to tip the teeth back, and I'd like to demonstrate that this moment. You can look in the mirror, you see that there is space behind the maxillary incisor teeth. There is no contact in centric occlusion or centric relation. I'll position her mandible in centric relation at this moment. Just relax, Connor. You're kind of back there anyway. We can have that same close-up. Good. So the space is available for us to tip the maxillary incisor teeth palatally. And the angulation of the tooth is such that we can afford a little tipping. This time we'll go off camera and come back with the appliance and show you the insertion and the activation. We return back on camera with the Hawley appliance completely constructed. I'd like to point out that we used a circumferential labial wire. this wire must be embedded firmly in the acrylic so as not to pull out during the length of time that the appliance is worn. By contacting the terminal molar tooth just under the distal height of contour, we gain the posterior retention that we need for the appliance. The wire is of an 0.036 diameter size. It's made with loops just distal to the cuspids, and these should be of sufficient length to give us enough wire for gentle activation over the maximum length that we can use. It contacts the incisor teeth. And due to the length of the wire, we put in a 0.016 wire between the bicuspids to stabilize the labial arch wire in an occlusal gingival direction. Looking at the models, I'll refresh you on the fact that we are trying to tip the maxillary incisor teeth to the lingual. We have space available. Therefore, we need the wire contacting both central incisor teeth and sitting passively in the mouth at first before activation. Try the appliance in at this time to make sure that it fits properly. The appliance does fit properly, so we'll remove the appliance. Because we'll need to remove the acrylic just lingual to the maxillary incisor teeth. This needs to be done so that the acrylic burr lies parallel to the lingual, the acrylic that is adjacent to the lingual surface of the maxillary teeth. After removing the acrylic, seat the appliance back on the cast to make sure that we've removed enough acrylic just lingual to the incisor teeth. We've outlined the free gingival margin behind the incisor teeth with a pencil, and as you can see, there is a space behind maxillary teeth. This time we're ready to activate the appliance. For the first appointment, we use a small activation. A three-prong plier is ideal for this procedure. By placing the plier at the top of the loop, we can squeeze the appliance gently, which moves the labial bow towards the lingual surface. You need to do this on both sides. And that move lowers the labial bow across the anterior segment. So we need to make a compensating bend in the anterior portion of the bow. These are gentle activations, and we'll have the patient back every 3 weeks to slightly activate the appliance again until the space is closed. Carla, do you feel pressure on any of the teeth?
Right here in the front.
We do want the patient to tell us that she experiences the feeling of a little pressure on the incisor teeth and not on any of the other teeth. It is not uncommon after an adjustment to perhaps have the loop around the cuspid area impinge upon the gingiva. And in this case, a small compensating bend should be made so that the appliance is comfortable on all the teeth except for a slight feeling of pressure on the incisor teeth. If the appliance is not comfortable, the patient will not wear it, and the appliance must be worn 24 hours a day, except at mealtime and during sports activities. When the patient removes the appliance at mealtime, we instruct them to clean the appliance with either lukewarm water or cold water and a toothbrush. We also give them a case to put the appliance in at mealtime or whenever it is removed from the mouth so that it does not get lost or broken. Before the patient leaves the office, she should be instructed on the proper way to insert and remove the appliance and practice this two or three times. Carla, will you put this in for us? We'll work with Carla on the insertion and the removal and bring her back when the case is completed. It's been 6 weeks since we delivered the Hawley retainer to Carla Brown to close a midline diastema. During that time, we made two adjustments. Now I'd like to show you our end result. Carla? As you can see, the space between the central incisor teeth is fully closed, and we are still free from occlusal interferences. This same Hawley appliance will now be used as our retention appliance. The program will vary slightly, but chances are we will have her wearing the appliance full time for 3 months, every other day for the second 3 months, every third day for another 3 months, and then only as it's required to keep the space closed. The difficulty with treating a midline diastema is the retention part of the treatment. The space closes fairly easily, but there's a great tendency for it to open. So in almost every case where we treat midline diastema, we inform the patient of the possibility of permanent retention.
You've been listening to a presentation from the University of Michigan School of Dentistry, which is dedicated to supporting open learning and open educational resources. This recording is licensed under the Creative Commons. It may be reused and redistributed for nonprofit use. Please attribute materials to the University of Michigan School of Dentistry and redistribute under this same license. For more information on how this and other University of Michigan School of Dentistry recordings may be used, visit www.dent.umich.edu/license.